Okay, thank you. Just to reiterate, my name is Dan Powell. I'm head of platform and managed account sales and relationship management for OneView. You've dialed into the IMAP webinar, and I will do a quick introduction. Just some housekeeping before we start. All participants will be on mute. There is no open mic. If we open up the mic, it just creates too much poor quality for background noise from the various people dialing in. If you do have a question, which we do encourage, at the bottom of the webinar GoToMeeting box, there's a thing called chat. If you type in that, your question, we will get to that question either during the course or at the very end of the webinar. We do propose for the webinar to finish at 1 o'clock, but we'll try to open up for questioning at about 1:45. The presentation will also have an audio and video recording of the event, which will be made available on the IMAP website in the next week. So you can get access to it there. How do we come up about today's subject? Well, today's subject is delivering on your portfolio promise of portfolio construction within a managed account. And why we pick this particular subject is because the number one issue that we see, and in particular I've seen, is AFSLs having to get their heads around the investment philosophy of a model portfolio solution, which is actually the key foundation block of any managed account offering. And the reason is it causes consternation with so many AFSLs, is though AFSLs may have an investment philosophy already documented, whether it be in the client's SOA or even in the FSG, most AFSLs do not have a prescriptive approach in establishing AFSL models that their advisors follow. And by setting up a managed account solution, it does generate a more prescriptive approach in how the investment philosophy is established and followed by the group and clients. So the questions come around the group investment philosophy, the charter, how it then lines up with the practice risk profiling tools, the type of underlying holdings, should it be managed funds, should it be direct equities, listed investment companies, ETFs, and so forth. And how do you establish a professional process around your investment committee? And how would the practices, current portfolios operate in a managed account versus outside a managed account structure? So if AFSL currently has a series of model portfolios, does that mean that the model portfolios and how they manage changes if it's outside versus inside a managed account structure? So they're the sort of questions that and issues that AFSLs really tend to focus on. These are not cost issues, these are not third-party provider issues, these are the internal philosophy that you develop when you create a managed account. So though today's presentation won't cover all these issues, it will hone in on how do you deliver on your portfolio and investment promise? Does it matter? And how you manage your model portfolio inside or outside a managed account structure? So with that, I'll pass over to the MC, Toby Potter, Chairman of IMAP.
Dan, thanks very much for that. And as Dan said, we have two presenters today. Dominic McCormick from Select Investment Partners, and Theo Maas from Arnhem Investment Management. The agenda today is that we're going to start off talking about asset allocation in a managed account environment, and Dom is going to take us through that. As Dan said, we'd welcome questions submitted by chat, and we'll probably address those, if they're specific to Dom's area, at the end of his presentation. And then Theo will talk about portfolio construction in a single sector environment. Dom's background is has been providing investment consulting services through DPM Financial Services and has over 30 years experience in investment management and financial services, including co-founding Select Asset Management in 2002. OneView purchased Select Asset Management in 2014, and he currently provides investment strategy input to Select and to their clients, and is portfolio manager of the Select Listed Investment Trusts and Select Real Returns Fund. So, Dom, please take us away.
Thanks, Toby. I'm hoping to make some general comments about asset allocation, specifically apply them to managed accounts, and then perhaps touch on some of the challenges today, because I think it is a really challenging environment for implementing any sort of asset allocation. But the first sort of key is why do we bother with asset allocation? Obviously, diversification is a key sort of driver, but you can't really get away from the asset allocation question. Even if you go down the route of using a passive strategic asset allocation approach, it's still that asset allocation that will matter for clients and impact their risk and returns over time. We often hear statements, you know, quite simplistic statements like asset allocation sort of determines 90% of returns or 80% of returns. I think that is a bit simplistic because it really depends on the type of approach that you're taking. If you are taking a very sort of conventional SAA, sort of using sort of passive or near passive funds, then it is true that asset allocation will pretty much, you know, be driven 90% of return. But if you're taking a more dynamic, a more absolute, greater use of alternatives, greater use of different types of investment strategies, then you can end up with a result where asset allocation is a less important part of the total return. So I think the answer to that, it really depends. And this sort of ties into sort of developing an approach or a philosophy, because I think it is crucial to come to sort of managing in a managed account or just generally to have a clear philosophy and approach. Obviously, I come from very much a contrarian background, and I think in a longer term sense, a valuation contrarian type approach is really the key way that you can add value in a longer term sense, both in terms of adding returns and reducing risk. I mean, there are other ways, sort of more momentum type approaches, but I tend to find that using some of the alternatives such as managed futures is a way to play that aspect. And it's better to stick to something that fits in with your mindset. And that depends a lot on how you think about markets, efficient markets, and also the nature of clients and how they can deal with downside and upside opportunities and risks. So, I mean, at that starting point, and we obviously haven't got time to sort of develop a lot of what has to go into developing the whole range of approach and structure, and I understand some of that's been covered in a previous IMAP webinar, particularly around the investment committee structure. But these are the key issues, and they're not easy to get right, particularly getting the people right and the decision-making process right. But it is something that needs a lot of thought of applied. Now, coming specifically to managed accounts and unique aspects of asset allocation in relation to those, well, firstly, they're not going to solve your asset allocation or issues or the challenges generally or in the current environment. I mean, it's just a service. It's not a specific product. So it will depend on those structures that you put in place around the investment committee, investment philosophy and approach. However, it is a better structure for more active and dynamic asset allocation approaches. Managed accounts do allow for much greater transparency, which allows for a more consistent asset allocation approach across clients. That obviously brings some challenges in that mistakes are applied across all clients and seen. And I think that applies to mistakes that are true mistakes that we would have preferred to avoid, and those that are perceived as mistakes in difficult times, which is often the nature of contrarian investing. But all of these issues emphasise the need for that more robust investment committee and processes and a clear statement of what the drivers are for various asset allocation decisions. And we're not suggesting this is in any way a science. My belief it is, it's an art using sensible tools, but it does stress the need for that robust approach. I mean, one of the issues for managed accounts historically has been some limitations on the instruments that can be used. I think this is improving over time as you've had the development of ETFs and various types of alternative vehicles that have allowed more robust portfolios to be produced. But there are still restrictions. I mean, historically, Select has been very much about building diversified portfolios, diversified multi-asset portfolios using a unit trust structure. And historically, that has had some advantages in the use of derivatives, hedging, for example. I think some of those constraints are starting to reduce for managed accounts because you now have a greater choice of hedged and unhedged funds. You've got sort of currency ETFs that allow you to sort of manage and adjust exposure there. So just very quickly onto the current challenges, because I wrote in the middle of last year that it's one of the most challenging environments for portfolio construction and asset allocation in my lifetime. I think it's only become more difficult in the 6 months since. And this is simply because, you know, pretty much all markets are expensive on both an absolute and historical basis. And we've had central banks as big drivers in this chase for yield and chase for return. And we've actually had an environment where expensive markets have got more expensive, and those that are cheaper, if you can find them, have tended to lag. So that makes sort of asset allocation driven from valuation basis pretty difficult. Perhaps more recently, global geopolitics is becoming a bigger factor, albeit it hasn't had a big impact on markets today, to my surprise. I suspect it will, particularly going forward from here. The other big theme that we've seen is the greater flow of money into passive vehicles and seen as an efficient way to implement asset allocation, which I agree. But I think there does need to be a degree of caution, because if you've seen money going into these vehicles, arguably the components of those have become even more expensive than the broader market. And it does raise the question of whether that's the best way to build a portfolio exclusively using passive vehicles in the current environment. So I might leave it there, and unless there are questions. And
thanks very much, Dom. I've got some questions. You touched earlier on about some of the inputs that go into your asset allocation decision-making process. I wonder if you'd talk a little more about the types of inputs those might be. So, and more to the point, I think, how dynamic some of those inputs are, your assumptions perhaps about risk and return within asset class.
Yeah, I think there's sometimes a misconception that the dynamic sort of means very frequent changes. I mean, sometimes the best decision is to do nothing and stick with your conviction on a asset allocation call. But the key driver, and it's only really a tool that's an input, is valuation. And it's obviously got to be longer term valuation. And there is a clear understanding that valuation is not a great short term timing indicator, but it is a good indicator of risk in markets and the path of longer term returns. So that's one of the key inputs. But then you've got to consider sort of elements such as sentiment, and then sort of more qualitative factors such as an assessment of sort of geopolitical issues and whether that should be having an impact on the risk premiums that you should be expecting from different aspects. So some of this is very judgmental, but it's necessary, particularly in the current environment, to consider some of those elements.
You mentioned that, you know, sometimes doing nothing is the right thing to do, and we'd all agree with that. But in a managed account portfolio, when the assets are actually going to be held by individual investors in individual investor-sized parcels, what is the frequency that you'd see asset allocation changes being implemented, for example, and compared to the frequency that you'd see security selection decisions being implemented?
Well, I think most investment committees operate on a monthly cycle, sort of some quarterly. And I think in terms of really considering the big picture asset allocation calls, that sort of monthly assessment makes sense, albeit you may make no changes. I think there does need to be the flexibility when big events happen or things change to consider change within that framework. But I think there's also this grey area where sometimes the line between asset allocation and security selection is a bit vague. I mean, we're obviously very active in the listed investment company space. And sometimes, you know, a global fund, for example, you may see it sell off because a big holder is offloading or the discount is blown out, and you see it as an opportunity, as a way to get global exposure in a sort of a lower risk way. So that can actually drive a decision to add exposure that is not necessarily reflecting just top-down issues, some sort of bottom-up elements. And I think one of the benefits of a managed account type structure is the flexibility to consider those as they occur, albeit it may be happen relatively infrequently.
And finally, one of the questions that I have is that anybody who reads other people's market commentaries sees quite a disparity of view about the kind of medium-term outlook for major markets. John Hussman, who's somebody I follow, has a view that expect 1%, and if you get it, you will have done well, particularly from US markets. To what extent does this disparity of asset allocation view impact your own formation of your position?
Yeah. Well, one of the things we spend a lot of time doing is thinking about scenarios. And there are times when we have a high conviction about, you know, the scenario going forward, and times like now where we don't. So we spend a lot of time thinking about different scenarios and building portfolios that are relatively robust in most of those scenarios. That's not easy to do, but we just had an investment strategy meeting yesterday where we really discussed this, and we were very explicit about we're not trying to develop a core view, we're trying to think about the various scenarios, the drivers for those, and the probabilities. And I think particularly, it was interesting, one of the strategists in the US made a comment when he was putting together his sort of forward-looking strategy piece that there's no point doing a full strategy piece for next year because the environment is so uncertain. And I think that's the environment we're living in. The combination of very expensive markets, and particularly in the key US market, and these sort of geopolitical changes that we're seeing has created a very uncertain environment. So I think in that context, you have to both consider valuation and the risks that's bringing. Because I think from valuation, you get sort of reasonably coherent views of where the long-term returns are likely to come from, but it doesn't give you that much guidance in the shorter term. But considering some of these risks on the geopolitical front has become more important.
I guess I said final, but this is the final question then. So how does the asset allocation decision process get articulated to advisors and through advisors to clients at a time when, listening to you, one conclusion that you might draw is, well, I don't know what's going on, so trust me. So how does the investment committee and the asset allocation specialists then articulate a view that this is the way we think the portfolio should be positioned in uncertainty?
Well, I think it's about highlighting some of the risks, because one of the problems in the current environment is, looking backwards, risk doesn't seem to be high. Realised volatility, the level of drawdowns that we've seen has been relatively low. So looking backward, there's we're seeing some clients who are thinking, well, they should be carrying more risk in the current environment, because they look back and if they had a bit more in equities, it would have done better. But I think they've got to really understand some of the structural reasons that might make sense to add equities, but also some of the challenges in different scenarios. I mean, one of the things we were emphasising yesterday is we're in a very asymmetric environment where, in what I believe has become the consensus view, which is this sort of reflation, sort of improved growth, the returns you get out of equities are pretty modest. But I think the probability of some of the more downside scenarios related to a re-rating of equities to more normal valuations and or some of these geopolitical issues resulting in higher risk premiums in some assets means that the risk return from major risk assets is not great at the moment. So I think people have to understand those downside risks in an environment where, looking backwards, there haven't been a lot of downside risks. So that's the real challenge at the moment.
Look, thanks very much, Dom, and to those who are listening to this. If questions occur to you through the rest of this webinar, please feel free to type them into the chat box, as Dan mentioned. Now, having started with the sort of broader sweep of how asset allocation is played out in a managed account environment, I want to move on to a much more constrained view of security selection and portfolio construction in a single sector. And our presenter for that is Theo Maas. So Theo Maas is joined Arnhem Investment Management in February 2007 after working with ABN AMRO Asset Management. Those of you who don't know Theo will quickly grasp from his accent that he's Dutch and was a founding partner in Fortnum Investment Partners. So Theo is currently the portfolio manager for Arnhem's two global SMA strategies, Arnhem Australia Plus and the Arnhem Global Growth. He's head of research for Arnhem and responsible particularly for the analysis of telcos, technology, and the gaming sector. Theo, thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Toby. After the session on more, call it top-down asset allocation, I want to go a little bit deeper and talk about portfolio construction in a single sector. And the sector in this case is global equity or equities in a broader sense, because we're going to talk about the mix between global and Australian equities as well. So I'd like to run through three topics. The first one is really all about the elephant in the equities room, and that's obviously sector concentration. Now, we know all about this, but we don't seem to be doing a lot about it, and I'll talk about a few of the issues there. So how can we actually solve for that? And in our view, the real issue is you start to need to think as an Australian, from an Australian perspective here, in terms of how you construct a portfolio. So let's start with the first topic. Sector concentration. Now, I don't think that this the chart that I've shown you here comes as a surprise to anyone here. We all know that the ASX is very much concentrated in two sectors. i.e. financials and materials. At the moment, it's about 54% of the index, which is obviously well ahead of any other index around the world, and certainly the MSCI world that I've shown here as well. In MSCI at the moment, it's around 23%, so still a healthy chunk of that index as well, but clearly not as concentrated as in Australia. Now, prevailing portfolio construction wisdom really talks about adding global to a portfolio and doing that by either an ETF or a more standard global equity fund to diversify away from this concentration risk. Now, the problem with that is that most of your clients will typically sell their cash holdings to fund this this move into global equity, and i.e. ending up with more dollar exposure in those particular two sectors that we were talking about. So it really doesn't solve that that issue of concentration risk. Now, why is concentration risk a potential issue? It is all about correlation. So on the chart here, I've correlated the four Aussie banks versus the MSCI World ex-Australia bank sector as well. And I've done it in the same currency just to get a good look on in terms of the correlation. And as you can clearly see, they move in similar direction. This is all after the GFC. I can tell you in the GFC things were even worse because everything was moving up or down at the same level. But it is clear that they are quite correlated. Now, the issue, of course, is that, first of all, the Aussie banks have done well, certainly a lot better than their global counterparts. Now, secondly, they pay a nice franked yield as well. So there hasn't been that much of an urge to actually sell down from this position to move to global, which has, looking back, has been the right decision. Now we move to the next slide. You can see that things are even worse in on the materials or resources side. The correlation is even higher in this sector. But it's the same picture again, that the Aussie counterparts have actually done better than the global ones, and obviously give you a nice yield as well, although that yield has certainly come down as of recently. So if we discuss this potential problem of concentration risk, and we combine this with the fact that Aussie investors have typically not sold their Australian banks and resources to fund going global, it's clear to us that it's time to do it differently, time to construct portfolios differently. So it's really, for us, it's all about constructing a portfolio from an Australian investor's perspective. And that sounds obvious, but a lot of the more standard global equity offerings out there are not. They are simply replicating a broader index like the MSCI World, and typically including the sectors that we've been talking about. We also know that investors are desperate for growth opportunity, to get that genuine diversification, i.e. to get exposure to sectors that they don't have exposure to yet. And we know the fact that the ASX has a very limited exposure to these high growth industries. And I've given the example here of information technology, which is a sector that is currently 1% of the ASX, i.e. there's really nothing there. So with all that in mind, I just want to run you through the way Arnhem constructs a portfolio. And for us, it's all about getting that complementary diversification, that exposures to complementary global industries. And we really do that by looking at our selection process or our construction process on so-called GICS 4 level. And GICS 4 is nothing more or less than the most detailed level of industries that GICS offers, or MSCI in this case. There's 156 of those industries, so it's going to a pretty deep level. And for us, it's all about selecting those industries, first of all, that are not available on the ASX, and second of all, offer interesting growth opportunities. Now, we do that by putting two scores together to make sure that we can rank all those industries. Now, the first score is all about growth, as I talked about. So we look at growth at various levels in the company, on revenue, EBITDA, long-term EPS growth. And it's pretty obvious that the higher the expected growth, the better the score. So these are all forward-looking scores. Now, the second one is all about overlap. And overlap is simply defined as the weight of the industry on the ASX versus the weight of the industry in the MSCI world. Now, does an industry have a lot of overlap? We give it a lower score. Doesn't have any overlap, it gets a good score. Now, it's nice to note here that 96 out of the 156 industries don't actually appear at all on the ASX, so they all have a good score, obviously. So there's plenty of choice available. Now, if we combine those two scores, we really end up with a long list of available industries ranked by attractiveness from those two dimensions that we were talking about, and we typically go after the top quartile of those industries. And that's really for us the way to select and construct a global equity portfolio which complements an existing Australian equity portfolio. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Sure, thanks very much, Theo. So, I mean, one of the questions that arises for me then is the question of correlation within those industries that are left over after you've got rid of the highly correlated industries in Australia. So this is the 96 that are left.
Yep.
To what extent are you conscious in portfolio construction within the SMA or the managed account?
Yep.
To what extent do portfolio construction and diversification issues arise for you, and how do you respond to those?
Okay. I'll answer that question, and I move to the last slide, which I forgot to talk about. But before I do that, let me go into that direction, because that's quite important. And we've done a lot of work around talking about correlation within global equity portfolios. So for us, having done the work in terms of looking at a standard approach, i.e. taking the whole global equity or the whole MSCI world as a benchmark versus looking at it from our perspective, i.e. excluding the most obvious overlapped sectors, financials and resources, we came to the conclusion pretty quickly that the return profile of those two different approaches are very similar. And that's even the case after looking at 30 years of data there. The one thing where you really benefit is you get a much lower risk. So that's all driven by this correlation perspective, obviously, because the lower the correlation in theory, the lower the risk should be as well if you start constructing portfolios from those sectors. And that's exactly what we saw. So from our perspective, and in terms of your clients as well, if we are looking at things like sequencing risk, we are looking to lower that risk profile, i.e. do not give up on the expected return, but do it with a lower risk profile. And that's really what our approach has shown us so far. So we're reasonably happy with that. Now, to come back to that final slide, because I definitely do not want to miss out on that. And that's really in terms of the constraints that an SMA structure might give you, because we know SMAs have a lot of benefits. They're very transparent, very flexible for your clients. But running those portfolios, you quickly run into practical issues as well. And I just want to give you an overview of some of those issues that we've come across in recent years. Now, first of all, this might sound obvious, is that your portfolios need to be quite concentrated. And the real issue is the minimum portfolio size. So you don't want to offer a product like this to really big numbers only. So it's to get to, for example, a portfolio, minimum portfolio size of 50K, as we use, you really need to start talking about 15 to 30 stocks, which fits nicely into our investment approach as well. The turnover needs to be low because, of course, your clients will see every transaction going on, including the costs related to that, which means that the corresponding investment horizon is typically a bit longer as well, and we typically talk about around 5 years. Now, things like nominal share prices, who would have thought that that might be an issue? But really, if you start buying a stock like Priceline in the US and it's you come to the conclusion that it's a $1,600 for one stock, then you can imagine pretty quickly that that might be an issue implementing that in a $50,000 portfolio. And that can actually lead to portfolio exclusion from this perspective. Now, the good point is that there are many, many alternatives for a stock like Priceline or any other example that you come up with. So it's not the end of the world, but it is a practical issue. Number of exchanges. Most platforms will typically talk about 7 to 10 exchanges being available. Now, that covers the vast majority of market cap available as well around the world, so it's not, again, a big issue. You can get away by looking for alternative listings if you can't buy the local listing. But again, something to keep an eye out. Some of the exchanges actually have very archaic rules, like minimum size parcels. And Japan is the obvious candidate there, where you actually have to buy 100 shares of each stock before you can start trading. Now, again, that is an issue for the minimum portfolio size as well. So, again, a solution might be to look for an alternative listing, i.e. an ADR, on the New York Stock Exchange or somewhere else, but not all of those Japanese companies have a liquid ADR available. And the last one I want to mention is currency hedging, which at this stage is not available yet. So the typical solution is to blend with some form of a hedged EFT or unit trust. We do know that some of the platforms are working on solutions there, and I'm a big believer that technology will find a solution here, but again, not currently available. And with that, I'm happy to take more questions.
Well, look, you touched on the platforms, Theo. So, as a portfolio manager, what's your experience been of the efficiencies and effectiveness of, without naming names,
yep,
of the platforms as administrators and custodians of directly held,
yep,
global equities?
Yep. Just to answer the question, my experience goes back, and for most of my sins, I have run unit trust in some shape or form. So the SMA structure is has been new, but I must say that I've been positively surprised by our experience that we have so far. So we've been doing this for the last 2-3 years now, and the easy or the simple conclusion is that there is not that much difference running a unit trust or running an SMA fund from a portfolio management perspective. Now, I've given all the practical considerations, but in practice, that sort of impacts the portfolio decisions once in every 50 decisions or so. Call it like that. So it's not something that we run into on a day-to-day basis. So from a purely from managing the fund, it's really not that different to managing a unit trust.
And you talked a little about turnover and a goal or a constraint being low turnover. So trying to express that, as a proportion, what sort of turnover should an advisor and their clients expect to see in this type of portfolio?
Yep.
And I guess the related question then is, does that mean core holdings and a sort of set of satellites, or does it mean everything's potentially up for consideration?
Yeah, it's a good question. Turnover is really the one upside and downside from an SMA structure is obviously transparency. So everything is out in the open. Everything I do from a portfolio management perspective can be seen by your clients. which in my view is a good thing. The downside is that you do it differently than you would do it for a unit trust. And simply this comes back to the fact that you want to be able to offer it to relatively low number of minimum portfolio size. So i.e. you do not want to go a lot higher than $50,000 in this case. And that really comes down to spreading that number of money over a number of stocks. Now, the number of stocks for us, it's really, we typically think in a range of 15 to 30. At the moment, we're in the low 20s. And that's really a number that works out well, both from our investment process perspective, as well as the fact that we are not going to offer a long, long list of transactions into a to an SMA investor, because obviously every little transaction has their own cost attached to them as well. So for us, all our 20 holdings are core holdings. It's not something that we look at from that perspective. You have to be very selective, because with a long investment horizon, you're not going to trade around certain positions. So we typically buy a company with the intention to hold on to it for about 5 years, which means that turnover is typically around 20% every year. And so far, so good. We've been in that range in the last 2 years.
And Dom was relatively cautious about his outlook for markets generally. Is your view of individual stocks and individual sectors,
yep,
coloured in the same way?
It partly is. I mean, I'll start with the obvious observation that going global means that you open up the opportunity set. You're not restricted to the top 20, 30 stocks in Australia that most clients will traditionally have had exposure to. So you are opening up the opportunity set. So that means that there's a whole range of stocks with similar or with different valuation levels out there to choose from. And that makes a big difference. Now, in general, I fully agree with Dom in terms of market valuations and risk profiles, et cetera, which are on the high side. And the market does not seem to price in risk correctly at the moment, in my view. But having said that, if you have that wide opportunity set, you do find enough examples of mispriced securities that you can take advantage of. And again, it is a much wider pond to vision from that perspective.
Look, thank you very much. Now, if there are questions from the audience, feel free to type them into the chat, and we'll feed them to both of our panelists.
I've got a quick question, Toby. It's Dan Powell here. It's to either Dominic or Theo. So, what we're seeing is people establish when they set up model portfolios, feel comfortable setting up, choosing whether it's a couple of equity Aussie equity managers, or for that matter, even maybe index managers. But when they come to international, it seems to cause a bit more consternation in the sense, do they go down and buy global SMAs, or which they can blend in to their own models, or do they go and buy ETFs which are popping up? And considering some of these ETFs are kind of derivative in investments, What do you see as the plus and minuses of both strategies?
Well, I think they should all be considered in the universe. Despite sort of my concerns that I stressed about broad passive indices and being a bit cautious there, I think you can identify certain markets that look more attractive, and using ETFs as a way to sort of skew a portfolio towards that makes total sense. I mean, if you can find an SMA manager that you're comfortable with the philosophy, then adding that to the mix sort of makes sense as well. as we touched on earlier, there are other choices such as, you know, listed investment vehicles, which have some additional elements to them, but they can be beneficial from a return and risk perspective as well. So I think they need to be all considered in the mix, and I don't think you get too adamant about just using one type of structure in that global exposure.
I would love to see everyone throwing all their money into an SMA, but the reality is that they have their pluses and their minuses, as Dom said as well. So for a more broad exposure to global equities, I think there are many good SMA alternatives that offer that and that offer the benefit of the full transparency, a limited number of stocks, your own tax base, and all of those good things about SMAs. But the reality is, if you as an advisor are worried about currency, if you as an advisor want to have specific exposure to emerging markets, all of those very specific elements will not be addressed typically in a standard global SMA fund. So for those issues, I can really see a blend, and that's what we have seen our clients do in practice as well, is blending these SMAs with ETFs or other unit trusts.
Can I just ask one more question? It's more of a kind of a question statement on that same point, or not same point, but same theme. One of the unintended consequences of platforms offering more international equity access direct is that there seems to be this kind of Netflix position in Australia where you buy a large index manager or global manager based here in Australia, you're paying way above basis points and you can buy it in their home country. So there's one large index manager I won't name. If you buy their US top stocks, you pay 10 basis points. Well, if you go on the Dow, you can buy it at 1 basis point. So the only difference is the currency management. So I don't know if there's any observations, maybe Dom, when talking about asset allocation, where you potentially could see these models buy more overseas-based assets and the asset allocation being currency getting more involved in it because it's not going to be managed by the manager.
Yeah, well, I think that limitation in terms of that currency exposure has been one of the factors that sort of has historically favoured sort of putting it together in a broader unit trust structure. But I suppose one of the elements that there is the challenging that is that there is more competition in the local sort of ETF market in terms of bringing some of those overseas listed vehicles at the same fee level or similar. And I think that's been a development the last year or two and will continue. But I agree, if you really want to open up that universe of that opportunity set, some of the overseas listed vehicles are sort of cheaper, particularly more liquid ways to get exposure to some of these vehicles.
All right. Look, thank you very much, Theo, Dom, for your time. As I mentioned, we will circulate the papers to all of those who participated. There'll be a video of the webinar on the website, and that'll be available within a couple of days. So thanks very much for that. And this is the end of today's webinar.